This morning with the series entitled Free. It's a study on the book of Romans, Romans 5, 6, and Romans 7. And if you've missed any of the previous two messages that I've delivered over the last 2 weeks, come and just speak to me afterwards. I have the YouTube links. They are available on YouTube. You can just download them and catch up. A lot of the foundation for this series has been set within those first 2 weeks, although you will be able to follow what I'm saying right now this week. But if you haven't, it's worth your while just to go and have a look at the two YouTube clips. They're about 50 minutes each long, but it sets a big foundation for the rest of the series as it is. Now, we're going to be dealing with, I think, what has to be one of the most mysterious pieces of Scripture in the New Testament this morning. And if you've read your Bible, and I hope you have, all right? If you've read your Bible, and I hope you have, then you may have realized, if you're astute, that the Bible is divided into two parts, Old and the New Testament. Are you with me? This is not that difficult, all right? If you look at the New Testament, you may realize that the New Testament itself is divided into three parts, okay? We have the Gospels, which is the life and teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the book of Acts, which is a part altogether on its own, which is the creation of the church. A creation of the church and the disciple of the roles within that. And then we have a whole bunch of letters known as the epistles. Now, these were letters that people like Paul, John, Peter, Jude, I can't even think of anybody else right now, but there's a whole bunch of them sat and wrote letters to specific churches around the Mediterranean. And usually these letters were to build the church up, to admonish the church for what they were doing wrong. It was letters to help them start to get it right. Now, when we look at the New Testament, we very quickly realize that two-thirds of the New Testament was written by a man who murdered Christians, who persecuted the church. You may have heard of him, Paul, the Apostle Paul. He wrote two-thirds of the New Testament. So when he sits down and he writes an epistle, he usually does it in a very specific, formulaic way. He takes the first half of the letter and he goes deep into theology. Very theological. He takes the second half of the letter and he becomes a practical teacher. How do I apply what I've learned practically into my life? And so what happens is very often when Kipia, me, and you come along, we open the Bible and we're confronted with words that we don't always understand. In Christ, through Christ, Christ in me. Now we have a grasp more or less of what that means, but we have no real idea what it truly means. What do those statements mean when Paul writes them onto paper? So what we do is we get this, we go, oh, that's nice, and we skip to the second half of the epistle because that's the part that we can get our teeth into. This is the part that we can really sink our teeth into. So we skip all the theology, we go to the practical stuff, and this seems to work for most of us for about a week. And then you find yourself doing exactly what you shouldn't be doing or what you did last week, which was wrong. You see, we just cannot seem to get it right. Romans 7 tells us that we love to do the things we shouldn't do, and we cannot do the things that we should. And then, of course, you come to church on a Sunday, and someone like me tells it, you need to get it right. In fact, I don't see why you can't get it right. And you know in your heart of hearts that you should get it right, but you're battling to get it right. And when I say you, I mean us, me included, all right? And then I say something just as you're about to snooze off, all right, in the service, that really wakes you up and you sit forward and you listen in anticipation because I have good news for you. No matter what you do, God will forgive you. Amen? No matter what you do, God will forgive you. Amen. And He does. But the problem is, I'm still struggling with this thing in my life that I just cannot get right. So what happens? We start to struggle a little bit less. And we start to pray for forgiveness a little bit more. It's the easy way out. So we're not battling as much with this thing anymore, but we're just asking God to forgive us every time we mess up. And this seems to work for many of us. You know, when we planted Origins Community Church, we had a mantra, Andrew and myself and the leadership team, we had a mantra that said it's easier to ask for forgiveness than ask for permission. So a lot of the church was built on, well, we'll just do it and see what they say sort of thing, you know. I think most churches are really built like that. So we get away with murder sometimes in the church. But that was where we were. We knew it wasn't right. We knew in our heart of hearts this wasn't the way we were supposed to do it. But we did it. And with enough prayer, we managed to quiet that little voice in our hearts down that says, you shouldn't be doing this. Because we know that once we've done it, we can go to God and God will forgive us for the sins that we commit. We know that. Thing is, the Apostle Paul is the lone voice in the desert. And he's saying to us that if you are living your life like that, if this is what you believe, then you are so missing the point. If this is what you believe, you are so missing the point. Let me ask you a question. What is the purpose of your life today if all you are doing is you're living with the idea of not getting it right and asking God to simply forgive you so that you can get into heaven? So many of us, the purpose of our life is exactly that. We are living for not what we can experience today, but what we are going to experience when I die. We are living for the future. We're not living for the present because of what is going on in our lives. We are living for a heavenly perspective. And there's nothing wrong with that. Don't get me wrong. There's really nothing wrong with that. But that is just a small, tiny part of the human experience. The bulk of the human experience, the broken body, sickly body, sinful human experience, is what happens now, not when I die. You know that so many people in the church live to die so they can get to heaven? Does that make sense? It doesn't make sense. Because God, when He makes you, when your mommy and daddy got together and you were conceived, He said, here is, what's it? Speck. Here is speck. She's pregnant for those of you who don't know. Here is speck. Okay, this is the life that I've given him. But this is the plans I have for him or her. We don't know yet. This is the life I have for him. Now, speck comes into the world and realizes he can't get it right. So all he does is he lives for this godly perspective, this heavenly perspective. And he fails to live the plans out that God has for each and every one of us today. I've lived like that. I'm sure many of you will agree with me. You've lived your life like that. I want to sum up the teachings of Paul in two statements. It's on the screen. I want to sum up the entire teachings of Paul into two simple sentences. And if you can get this, I promise you, you can get it right. Sin does not control where you go when you die. Does that sound like a church statement to you? No, it doesn't, because the church doesn't teach that. Sin does not control where you go when you die. And the second thing that Paul says is, he says this, sin does not have to control what you do while you live. Now, I'll get to the explanation of that just now. Get this. If you were here the last 2 weeks, you would have heard me say this. What is sin? Is it a noun or is it a verb? It's a noun. It is something physical. It is not an action. It is not a choice. It is something that lives within us. If you were the last 2 weeks, you would have heard me say that when Adam disobeyed God in the Garden of Eden, sin, what? Entered into the world. Now, is sin, if it entered into the world, something real? Or is it something that I choose, create, fantasize, make up? No. It is something that is real. We cannot, as Christians today, distance ourselves from the sin that is within me. We cannot separate ourselves from the sin that is within me. And it's in this where we find the struggles that we go through on a daily basis. See, what we can do, and this is what you need to get, what we can do today is we can choose not to engage in the sin that is in me. At the end of the day, we all have that choice. Sin is a part of the human makeup. It's who we are. As far as I know, there was only two sinless people in the world. Jesus and Mother Teresa, and I'm not so sure about her. All right. Jesus was the only sinless person in the world. So what does that make you and me? Come on, say it loud. Sinners. Now, most people don't like it when I call them a sinner, but that's what you are. Deal with it. You're nothing else but a sinner because it sits here. It came into your life because of the actions of Adam in the Garden of Eden. It has been part of the human experience from day one almost. So Paul asks us two questions. He says this, and you need to answer them for me. Have you given control of your life over to the Lord Jesus Christ? Is he the master and the Lord of your life? Anybody? Hey, hands up. I'm going to see those hands. Come on. Anybody? All of us. Awesome. So you've given your life over to the Lord Jesus Christ. Am I right? Am I correct in assuming this? Good. Then why, the second question is, then why are you living your life as if you've never left Adam? Why? Why are you living your life today as if you've never, ever left Adam? And so what the series is trying to do to you over the next couple of weeks is simply this. In week one, we looked at what the problem was. Remember? We know there's a problem in our lives. Anybody have a problem in their life? We know the problem is there. We just don't know what it is. Am I right? I mean, when it comes to this whole sin thing, we have no idea what it actually is in our lives. And in week 2, 3, and 4, we start to look at what Paul's explanation is in the book of Romans as to why we cannot do what we are supposed to do and why, oh Lord, we find it so easy to do the things we shouldn't do. Ever thought that? Ever thought? I know, I think that almost every week. Why can't I just do what I'm supposed to do? And why do I find it so easy to end up doing things that I shouldn't be doing? And if you're sitting there thinking, well, that's not my experience, then lying is a sin. Just remember that, all right? See, if you read your Bible, even if you don't believe in the Bible, you can agree that this struggle is inherent in each and every part of your life today. And the thing is, Paul agrees with you. Paul doesn't call it temptation, because very often we don't like to be called sinners, but we like to be called people who are tempted. Tempted. I'm tempted. I struggle with temptation. Now I don't struggle with temptation. I find it easy. You know, it's not temptation. It's sin. And Paul calls it a sin. He doesn't sugarcoat it. He calls it as it is. And Paul tells us, oh why, last week, it's not on the screen, sorry. Oh why, Lord, am I such a wretched person? Paul is beating himself up because this man who wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, cannot get it right. So I want to go to slide 1, and I want you to turn with me to Romans 7, verses 15 and 18. And if you're honest with yourself this morning, well then this is the mantra, this is the slogan for your life. Paul writes this, he says, I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. Paul goes on. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil, and again, he doesn't call it temptation. He doesn't water it down. He calls it what it is. The evil I do not want to do, this I keep doing. Honestly, I know that this has been, on one level or another, all of your experiences. It certainly has been mine. I know what I'm supposed to do, but I can't do it. I know what I shouldn't do, yet I find myself doing it. And I'll tell you what, it's as frustrating as hell to so many people because we cannot get it right. Paul goes on. And he gives us his explanation as to why we cannot get it right. And this is key to the whole teaching of Romans 5, 6, and 7. This is the key that unlocks everything to you. He says this, Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I that do it. Get this. But the sin living in me that does it. do it. You see, the fact that you got your eye on the secretary at work, the fact that you are skimming, the fact that you're logging onto porn sites and doing drugs and beating your husband, the fact that you do all of those things, according to this piece of scripture, it's not your fault. It's because of the sin that lives within you. To which a lot of you go, I like this answer. This is a good answer. Here was a man, Paul, who knew a lot. I mean, he was a clever, clever man. He had learned a lot from just sitting at the disciples' feet and arguing with them. Paul wasn't your atypical Bible school student. He sat and he argued with Peter. In fact, some of the greatest fights between Paul and Peter we find in the book of Corinthians, where Paul addresses some of the injustices that the disciples were putting onto the people. These were the people who walked with Jesus. Some of the biggest arguments he has is with the disciples. Now, I'm sorry. If I had a time machine and I can go back in time and I would sit with the disciples, the last thing I'd want to do is argue with someone like Peter. Or in fact, any of the 12. Because they know a lot more than I will ever know. But this was a man who argued with him. He wanted to learn everything he could about the Lord Jesus Christ. And he comes to a realization after everything that he read, everything that he learns, that there's a reason why he can't get it right. There's a reason why he is struggling with a sin that is so inherent in his life. Now, I want to briefly touch on what I said to you last week so that you can get an overview of what I'm talking about. And I want to remind you of this quickly. Because we were born of Adam, all right? Because we were born of Adam, we what? We inherited the consequences of what? His sin. That simply means that you and me, before we took our first breath, when the doctor lifted us up and smacked us on the bottom of the feet or the bum, wherever they did in those days, we were sinners. We were born sinners. Get what I'm telling you right now. You are not a good person that does bad things occasionally. You are a bad person that does occasionally good things. And we can agree with that. Because of Adam's monumental screw up in the Garden of Eden, we need to understand that sin is a noun. It is a reality. It is something tangible. It is real. It is physical. And it sits right here. Because of what Adam did, we experienced condemnation. Because of what Adam did, we ceased to be what? Like God. So that makes us what? Unlike God. And it makes us something I called you over the last 2 weeks. Ungodly. It makes you ungodly. You're not ungodly because of something you did. You're ungodly because you are not God. Simple as that. Get what I'm telling you right now. You are ungodly because you are not God. Whether you like it or not, you as a person are a bad person. And you will agree with me because if you think back to what you did last week, to some of those monumentally stupid decisions you made that led you to disobeying the Lord of God, you could only but agree with me. So what happens when you give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, guess what? You're taken out of Adam. You're unbaptized from Adam, and you are baptized, placed into Jesus Christ. If you remained in Adam, well then condemnation becomes you. Why? Well, because what is true of Adam remains true of you. If Adam was condemned and you remained in Adam, so you too would be condemned. Now, so God comes along, he takes you out of Adam, places you into Jesus. All of a sudden, what is true of Jesus now becomes true of you. And that's nice, because now we think, well, we're in Jesus, that's awesome. But the problem is, because Jesus died to our sins, we too have to die to those sins. Why? Well, because what is true of Jesus is true of us. This simply means that the sin in you doesn't die, it doesn't go away. What it does mean is when Jesus, or when God comes and places you, baptizes you into the Lord Jesus Christ, sin loses its power. Sin loses its power. It doesn't go away. It does not go away. It's always here. But it loses the hold that it has over you. It loses its power. And so when Jesus dies, we die to sin with him. Thing is, when Jesus is raised from the dead, we rise from the dead with him. Which brings us to the question this morning. So what? What do I do with it? What do I do now? You see, you may feel that I'm excessively repeating what I've done over the last 2 weeks, and I've done it with a purpose, because this is such a complex, complex teaching. And you know what? You may not think that I'm listening to you when you stand having tea after the church, but I listen to you. And so many of you are struggling with Romans 5, 6, and 7 because you do not understand the wording. You do not understand what Paul is trying to tell you here. And that's why I'm repeating this truth over and over and over. Because many of you, in a way, have asked this question. Okay, so what do we do with this new theology? What do we do with this new way of thinking that Andre has just thrown at us? And I want to give you three words that are going to help you to get this right. Declare, decide, and devote. It's a 3D. Okay? So I want you to turn with me to Romans 6, verse 9. If you got your Bibles with me, otherwise I'll put it up on the screen for you. Paul writes the following. He says, "For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again." Are we in agreement with that? All right. "He cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him." Now, the main precept of the Christian faith is this: Jesus came, Jesus taught, Jesus died, Jesus rose. Because of faith, we stand sanctified and justified in him. That's the main precept of the Christian faith. For us to grasp this important aspect of the sin that lives within our lives, we need to know that even once we are placed in Jesus Christ, when we are sinning our brains out, sin still doesn't have power over me. Sin has still lost its power over me. The thing is, when I'm sinning and I'm being placed into Jesus Christ, I have given it permission to come out and play. I have given it permission to come out and wreak havoc. It boils down to choice. At the end of the day, all of us would say, well, you know what? The devil made me do it. Or God made me do it. Or the stars or the fates or whatever made me do it. Wrong. You made you do it. Simple as that. You choose to engage in sin. You choose to give some of that power back to sin when you allow it into your life. Sin becomes a toothless junkyard dog when we are placed in Christ. And we take away, God takes away its power. We become untouchable. Why? Well, because what is true of Jesus becomes true of me. Paul continues. "The death he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. As a man, Jesus Christ died. And he died only once for all past, present, and future sin." All right? As a man, he died only once for everybody that has lived, is living, and will live. He died once for all. And for us to grasp this, we need to understand that Jesus... Sorry, I'm repeating myself, looks like it, yeah. It boils down to a decision that we need to make. Sorry, it's the next screen that I need to get to. And it's here where Paul tells us actually what we need to do. Sorry, I lost my place there. Romans 6:11. This is what Paul tells. He says, "In the same way, count yourself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus." In the same way, count yourself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. And this is an amazing teacher, because what Paul is saying in those first three or four words, in the same way, is he telling us that because of what Jesus did, we are to do the same thing. In the same way that Jesus counted himself dead to sin, so we are to count ourselves dead to the sin. It doesn't mean that sin is dead in me. It just means that we are to count ourselves dead to the power that sin has over us. Sin has no more power. Death has no more power. Satan has no more power over your life. Why? Well, because we are to count ourselves dead to those things. We need to view our lives differently, and we are to then count ourselves alive to God in Christ. I want to have a look at that word count very quickly. Where is it there? I want to have a look at that word count. When we look at the term count, it's an accounting term. It's a mathematical term that says to consider, to accept, to believe, to factor in. I want to add another word to that. It's the word declare. This is the first word, the first D that we are dealing with. We are to declare ourselves dead to sin. Now let me ask you a question, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I cannot declare anything to be truth if I don't believe it. Am I right? I cannot declare that anything to be the truth if I simply do not believe it. You see, when we are accused of something and we are innocent, we will declare our innocence. Why? Because we believe it. When we look at politicians, most of us will declare that they're idiots. Why? Because we have ample proof of that. We declare because we know it's the truth. All right? We will not declare anything if we do not believe it to be true. We don't believe, or we cannot declare. Let me put this this way. Let's go real here. We cannot declare that we believe Nelson Mandela to be alive because we simply actually don't know. We don't believe it. We don't know it because nobody's telling us anything. You see, when we declare something, we have to believe it before we can declare it. And when we, and this morning we are to declare that sin, and I did it last week, you remember, sin is no longer my master. Sin is no longer my master. Say it after me. Sin is no longer my master. Okay, say it again. Sin is no longer my master. Okay, now raise your hands if you can declare that. 5 of us can raise our hands and declare that sin is no longer our master. That means, from where I'm standing, that 70% of you don't believe that. Don't believe that sin is actually no longer your master. Why? I've spoken about this till I'm blue in the face over the last 2 weeks. Let me just take you through, because I think I need to break away a little bit here. Who of you believe that Jesus is your Lord and Savior? All right. Awesome. Now the numbers are looking a bit better. Who of you believe that if He's your Lord and Savior, you have been unbaptized from Adam and you have been rebaptized, placed into Christ? Numbers are still looking good. Okay. Why are you still living like you're still living in Adam? Why can you not this morning declare to me that sin isn't your master anymore? I'll tell you why, because tomorrow you're going to mess up. Tomorrow I'm going to mess up. But the problem is, it's not about messing up. It's not about sinning. It's about understanding that I have a choice before I mess up. It's about understanding that I can make a decision and I can declare that when I open my email and somebody has sent me a picture of a woman with no clothes on, I can declare that sin is no longer my master. And I switch the machine off. Sin, say it again, is no longer my master. Can you declare it? Who can declare it? Okay, it's looking a little bit better. Lord, I'm sorry. Paul goes on and he says, and this is what you need to get, because if you don't believe that sin, or if you believe that sin is still mastering you, still owns you, then you need to understand the precept of this piece of scripture. He says, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desire. Now, let's look at the tense of the statement. Therefore, in other words, I've told you what you're supposed to do, so now listen to me. Therefore, do not, don't, that's the word, let. Do not let. What does that tell you? What does that tell you? Sorry? We have the power. We are not to allow. We are not to give permission to. We are not to open ourselves up to. We are not to let sin reign in our bodies. Where's the choice? God? The devil? No, no. Us. That's where the choice lies. We are not to let it reign. And he goes on, he says, the mortal body so that you obey its. That word its tells us it is a real, physical, tangible thing that sits right here. And we are in negotiations with it every single day of our lives. Do I allow it to do what it needs to do, wants to do? Or do I resist it? I want to ask a question of you this morning. When you wrestle with sin, we all wrestle with sin. We all argue with it the whole time. When you wrestle with sin, which side of the argument do you identify with? Which side of the argument do you normally find yourself on? Which side of the argument do you find yourself agreeing with? Because the truth is, when you are confronted by sin, and we can use the word temptation here, when you are tempted by sin, you will always, always choose sides. You can never remain neutral. You cannot stand back and say, well, God, you there, sin, you there. Ah, touch, pause, engage. No. You're in that scrum. You're playing this game with them. And whatever side you choose, that is going to be the side that wins. Let me repeat that. Whatever side you choose, that is going to be the side that wins. What does it tell us? It tells us sin is our choice. To sin or not to sin, our choice. Nobody else's choice. Nothing can make me do it. God doesn't have that power. Sin doesn't have that power. The devil doesn't have that power to make me do what I need to do. Or want to do, I should say. We choose to do it. It is an age-old battle that has been fought since the garden. And whichever side wins is the side that you choose. Now, many of you don't want to hear this. Many of you don't want to hear me tell you this, but at the end of the day, God is going to say to us, come. So tell me, what did you do with this thing in you? What did you do with this sin in you? How did you manage it? And you're going to go, well, I think I did okay. He says, oh, no, you didn't. That's where you messed up. No, he won't do that. God throws our sins into the sea of forgetfulness. He forgets about it when we go to him in forgiveness. But do not find yourself standing before God without asking for forgiveness. Because then that list I spoke about, it's a coming out. See, what you choose or how you choose to engage in sin is going to identify where you stand. Either you are in Jesus or you're standing with Adam. Either you're doing the right thing or you're doing the wrong thing. Either you are fighting evil and doing good or you're fighting good and doing evil. When you find yourself identified with Adam, then this is more or less what you sound like. Well, you know what? I've always struggled with this sin. You know what? My mom or my dad or my cousin's cat, they struggled with a sin, and it's a family thing, so I'm struggling with a sin. It's hereditary, yeah. You know what? I'm just not strong enough to resist the temptation. You know what? I have an addictive nature. Does that sound familiar to any of us? Huh? It all sounds familiar to me. When we start sounding like that, then we find ourselves standing and aligning ourselves with Adam. Now, when you align yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ, then this is what you're going to sound like. No, that is sin trying to rule me. No, that is sin that is trying to conquer me. No, that is sin that still thinks it has power over me. And I know that when I allow sin into my life, I told you the first week, what comes with it? Death. Thank you. Someone was listening. Death comes with it. You know what? I've had enough of death in my life. I've had enough of death in my family, in my children's lives, in my finances. I've had enough of death. So why would I choose to align myself with Adam when I'm a child of God? Paul tells us that if you continue to behave the way that you behaved before you found Jesus, then you are struggling. You have not made the correct decisions yet. Paul continues therefore, and he says, Therefore, do not let. It's a choice that you make. And so the second word that I want to look at this morning is decide. We are to decide not to let sin rule over us. Have you ever made that decision? Have you ever decided, this is it, I'm drawing the line here, I am not going to allow sin to control me? How's that working for you? It's hard. Of course it's hard. Of course it's difficult. And God expects us to do that. But he doesn't expect us to get it right. Because if we can get it right, then we don't need his grace. If we can get it right, we don't need his mercy. In fact, if we can get it right, we don't need the cross. Decide not to let sin rule you. So first of all, I declare that sin is no longer my master. D number one. I then decide that it will no longer rule me. D number two. I decide not to give sin back its power. I decide to strip sin of all of its power and leave it bleeding at the foot of the cross. That's a decision that you and me have to make. Paul continues, and this is where he gets a little bit more theological. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness. Listen to what Paul is saying here. Do not offer. Okay, let's have a look at that word. When I offer something, what am I doing? I'm giving it away. So when I'm offering part of myself to sin as an instrument, what am I doing? I'm surrendering to the sin that is in me. I'm allowing it to do what it needs to do. So do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness. What Paul was saying is we are not to do that. We are not to offer our hands, knees, heels, and elbows. You remember that ad? Okay. Nothing. Zippo, toes, toenails, nothing must be offered to sin as an instrument of wickedness. So guys, let me tell you something now. When you're viewing porn on your computer, you're offering your eyes and your mind as an instrument of sin. When you're committing adultery, you're offering your hands and your minds and other bits and pieces as an instrument of sin. When you gossip and slander and lie, you're offering your mouth as an instrument of wickedness. When we say hurtful things, we use our mouths. When we do use hurtful things, we use our hands. When we go to places, we use our feet. We use our bodies as instruments of wickedness. Paul continues and he writes this, and this is the follow-up to this piece of scripture. He says this, but rather, so he tells us there is an alternative. There is something else you can do. But rather, offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Paul is telling us that we are to give, not to give our bodies to sin and to evil. Why? But we are rather to offer ourselves to God as a sacrifice. Now, I've added the word sacrifice into that statement. Rather offer yourself to God as a sacrifice, as those who have been brought from life to death. And the reason I did that was to tell you something. When we give away something, what are we doing? 9 out of 10 times, it is a sacrifice. If it's a birthday gift, we've sacrificed money for that. If it's just a gift to help someone, we've sacrificed something to be able to do that. It's a sacrifice. And so what God is saying is take your bodies, offer it as a sacrifice. And I'll tell you what, if you're involved in some sort of a sin and it's maybe an addictive type of sin, you are sacrificing that sin up because it's something that you like. If you didn't like it, you wouldn't do it. So the sacrifice is that I'm willing to give up the sin that I like, this thing that I enjoy doing, I'm willing to sacrifice that as a tool for righteousness for God. The question, of course, we ask ourselves is why? Why are we to offer ourselves to God? Well, the answer is very simple. Through the gift of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, God takes us out of death and he puts us where? In life. Now, we can't think short term. Most of us are not going to see 80, all right? Some of us have. but most of us are not going to see 80. That is such a short-term viewpoint to life. When God says, I take you out of death, he's not talking about the physical death. He's talking about a spiritual death. I take you out of a spiritual death because of condemnation, because of what Adam did. I take you out of that, and I baptize you into Jesus. I give you eternal life. What is eternal life? Well, the life that we are living today is but one grain of sand on the longest beach in the world. Does it put into perspective what eternity is going to look like? Now, I don't know about you, but I really think sitting on a cloud with a harp is far preferable to sitting in a jacuzzi full of hot lava. That's just my thought, you know? Okay, so I'm going to go for the eternal heavenly perspective. I like that idea. I think it's nice. It's good, all right? But that's what God does. He takes us out of a spiritual death. He puts us into eternal life with Him in a feast, in a party that just doesn't stop. Doesn't that sound great? That sounds awesome. Paul continues, and offer every part of your body, of yourself, to Him as an instrument of righteousness. And that brings us to the third word that starts with a D, devote. Devote your body to God. Now, I don't know about you, but maybe this isn't part of your spiritual ritual, but for many of us, we do quiet times. I drive down to this place almost every morning, and I sit in my car, and most of the mommies think I'm stalking their children when I sit there, but that's besides the point. They know me by now, so it's cool. They're quite happy with it. But I sit in my car here, and I pray over that property. Am I right? Yes, that property there, where they're going to build for us. I pray over that. I pray for the school. I pray for you guys. I pray for my family, my business. I pray for everything that I can possibly pray for. Some of you know this as a quiet time. Some of you will call it a devotional time. No matter what you call it, it's time that you spend with God. Now, Andy Stanley, who's given me a lot of the material for this series, he tells the story of his own devotional time. What he does this, and this is absolutely mind-blowing. He says, he sits in his prayer, and it sounds like, he says, Dear Heavenly Father, take my hands, because I know that at one point or another today, sin is going to ask that I do something wrong. Lord, take my mind, because at some point today, sin is going to require that I lust or think something wrong. Lord, take my feet, because I know that somewhere along the line, sin is going to ask me to go somewhere which brings you no glory. Lord, triple take my mouth, because somewhere along the line, sin is going to require that I say something funny, or say something hurtful, or say something malicious. Father, take my arms and my legs and my body, because I know that at one point or another, sin is going to require that I do something sinful. And then he ends his prayer like this. He says, Lord, take my body, because sin is not my master. Doesn't that just rock, hey? Isn't that just amazing who of you pray like that? I'm going to be honest, I don't. I learned a huge lesson last week when I prepped this, because that's what we're supposed to do. Sin doesn't start with me logging on to www. Where does it all start? It starts up here. This is where Satan has his biggest sandbox, and he's playing big time in that sandbox at the moment. Now, we need to kick him out of the playground. We need to get rid of him out of this playground, because he's going to hurt you. Do this. And what you are doing this morning is you are declaring the first D, that sin is not your master. You are deciding that it no longer has any power over you. And you are devoting your entire existence to the will of God. I remember when I was called to this ministry, to plant this church, one of the first things I did was laugh at God, which is probably not a good thing to do, but I did. I laughed at him because I didn't think that I could do this. I laughed at him because, and don't tell anybody, but I'm a terrible Christian, okay? Just thought I'd share that with you. I laughed at him because I wasn't capable of doing this. The only thing that I was getting right was to get it wrong consistently. And so the end result was that I started to doubt the call that God had placed upon my life. But the thing is, and again, please don't tell anybody, I still don't get it right. Okay? Just thought I'd share that with you. I still don't get it right. When Paul writes the words in 1 Timothy 1:15, he says this. He says, here is a saying you can trust. They're going, oh, this is a good start. I like this. It should be accepted completely. I can live with that. Jesus Christ came into the world to save the sinner. Awesome. Rocks. Amazing scripture. And then he says this, I am the worst sinner of all. And I'm going, Lord, was he standing over my shoulder when he wrote that? Because that's me. I know that I am the worst sinner of all. You have no idea how often I stand up and I'm preaching and I feel like the biggest, biggest hypocrite. Because of what is happening in my life. Because of the sin that is going on in my life at that point. You have no idea how I struggle sometimes with just trying to get it right. I'm not the pastor that stands elevated and preaches down to you. You guys know that. I talk to you because I'm on the same level as you guys. I struggle with the same issues that you struggle with. I sin in the same way that you sin. I fall in the same way that you fall. That's what I love about this church. When I fall, people stand up for me. When you fall, I may not even be there to stand up for you, but other people in this church stand up for you. So here's what we got to do. This whole thing about not getting right what we're supposed to get right and doing what we shouldn't be doing, stop beating yourself up about it. Accept the fact that you are a sinner. Now, there are many churches where if I had to preach this sermon, half the congregation would probably leave. Because they don't believe that they're sinners. In any case, it's such a hard word. I mean, why use it in church? It's so unpolitically correct. The fact of the matter is, you are a sinner. Deal with it. We are all sinners. We need to deal with it. So stop beating yourself up when you can't get it right. Because nowhere in the Bible does God say, you have to get it right. What he does say is, listen, I love you. I love you so much. And I know that you're going to mess up down the road. I know that you're going to do something you shouldn't do. I know that you're going to, one tequila, two tequila, three tequila, floor. You know the thing, okay? I know that you're going to do that. I know all these things. But I need to tell you a quick secret here. And most of your brothers and sisters know this. Grace is bigger than anything you can do. My love is bigger than anything you can do. And here's a truth, and I'm nearly finished, that I picked up as I prepped this message. And I want you to grasp this because this is mind-blowing. Turn with me to Colossians 3 verse 1. It's up there if you want it. Set your mind on the things above. Oh, that's cool. Think about heaven. Done. Not on the things that are on the earth. Okay, that's a little bit more difficult. I live here. So how can I not think about the stuff that I'm going through right now? This is a very practical teaching. Think about the heavenly perspective. Think about the godly, eternal perspective. Don't think about what's happening right now. I get this. Paul goes on. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. We need to get this. I've taught this to you over the last couple of weeks. You died to sin and evil. And you were placed where? In God through Jesus Christ. Do we understand that? Are we all on the same page when it comes to that? Awesome. It's the next line that blew my mind. And this is it. When Christ, who is our life. Ever thought of it like that? We know that God is in us. We know that Christ is in us. But how many of us have surrendered this Christ that is in us to absolutely and without any reserve, absolutely take over control? Where Christ is our life. And here's where it dawned on me, because it was morning. But here's where it dawned on me. Who of you think right now that you can live the Christian life? Come on. Honestly, who of you think you are living a Christian life today? I mean, don't be shy. Put your hands up. Taylor, I saw that, you know. Okay. Honestly, you guys think you can live the Christian life? I've got a bit of bad news for you. The only person who can live the Christian life today is Jesus Christ himself. And I realized that as long as I try to emulate God, as long as I try to copy Jesus Christ, as long as I try to do better, not to sin, as long as I try to get it right, as long as I try to do all these things that Jesus Christ did, the end result is that I am going to fail. How's that for them apples? Why do I say that? Because the benchmark that the Lord Jesus Christ placed for you and me to live at is way too high for us. It is perfection. And sorry, Anybody here perfect? Just let me count. Let's call that zero, okay? None of you are perfect, okay? None of us are perfect. So the only person who can live the Christian life in its purest form is Jesus Christ himself. So to which many of you will say, well, why do I bother trying then? No. God is saying, you better try. You need to try. But understand, don't beat yourself up when you don't get it wrong. Come to me. Don't beat yourself up when you get it wrong. Whatever. Okay. Don't beat yourself up if you don't get it right. Are you happy now? Okay. All right. Because all you need to do is, you need to come to me. You just need to come and kneel down before me. Ask for forgiveness. And you know what? I have this really, really big bucket of it. It'll never empty out. And I will give it all to you if I need to. Guys, it's not a matter of trying harder to get it right, because you will never get it right. It's not a matter of trying to perfect it, because you will never perfect it. It's a matter of getting out of bed in the morning, and as your feet hit that floor, acknowledge first of all that you are a wretched sinner. I know you don't want to hear this, but listen to me. Acknowledge first of all that you are a wretched sinner, that you cannot get it right. You cannot live the sinless life. In fact, you're not going to get through the next few minutes without sinning. But you know what? Jesus, you can. You can. You can do it. You can get it right. And because my life is where? In you. I'm going to piggyback on your grace. Doesn't that just blow your mind? Hey, before we even ask for forgiveness, God is saying, who's that? Take. I've got so much of it. Sin is not your master. Declare that. Decide right now that it has no power over you. No power at all. And then devote your whole body to God in service. The decision is yours. Can you declare that? Can you declare that sin no longer is your master? Cool. Hands are looking a bit better. Can you decide not to allow it to rule over you? I think so. Am I going to get it right? No. I'm going to fail tomorrow, I promise you. Can you devote every member of your body to God? Yes, I can try. The thing is, you can't. You won't. I can't. We won't. But God can. God can. Next week we're going to be having a look at the whole piece of scripture that really ties all of this up. And it's Romans 6:14, if you just want to bring it up, there it is. For sin shall no longer be your master. Now, do we agree with that? Okay, awesome. We agree with that. Because you are no longer, or you are not under the law, but under grace. Now, what does that mean? Well, you see, I'm the senior pastor in this church, so I'm going to leave it up to Dave to try and sort out for you tomorrow, next week. I'm going to leave it up to Dave to try and explain to you why we are no longer under the law, but under grace. And apparently most people in this country think they are no longer under the law, but under grace, the way they act. So Dave, you got your hands full, dude. I'm going to leave it in your hands, and I just pray that you would give all the prayers to Dave so that he can get this right, because this is what's going to tie everything up for us next week as we finish off this series. Let us pray. Father, we just thank you this morning for your amazing love. Father, I need to say to you from my own perspective, Lord, that I thank you for giving me the gift of being able to discern your word and being able to teach this to these amazing people who come through this door every Sunday, Lord. I just pray that you would bless them right now, Father, that you would prepare their hearts for next week as Dave brings this message, that the words of his heart and the words of his mouth may be acceptable in your sight, and Father, that people may have their lives changed by what he says and what you say through him. Lord, we love you. We know that we can't get it right, but you can. Jesus, we worship and we adore you and we praise you, and we know that we are going to mess up, but you won't. Father, we just thank you for all this. We pray this in your holy and wonderful name. Amen.